Okay. Now, on that note, what we discover is the first professional team of black ball players was the Cleveland Tate Stars. They formed in 1918. And in 1922, they joined the recently formed Negro League. The owner of the Tate Stars was a guy named George Tate, who played baseball at Oberlin College and was a local businessman in Cleveland. Between 1922 and 1950, and we'll do this by the numbers, it's 28 years, 11 teams, 16 owners, 20 managers. Those teams had 17 East-West All-Star Game representatives. The city hosted one East-West All-Star Game in 1942 that Brad Sullivan, former Sabre Jack Graney chapter president, chronicled. There were two pennant winners, one world's champion. Those teams produced seven future major leaguers and three future members of the Hall of Fame. They went by names like Browns, Elites, Hornets, Tigers, Cubs, Stars, Giants, Red Sox, Bears. And what those teams had in common was mediocre play. Only one of them, the Cleveland Cubs in 1931, had a winning record. The rest were at 500 or below. Until 1942, there was one team with staying power. That was the Buckeyes, who we're going to talk about this evening a little later in greater depth. They were owned by a guy named Ernest Wright, who was from Erie, Pennsylvania. He was a hotel and nightclub owner. He came to town and he partnered with Wilbur Hayes, who was a local sports promoter. As I mentioned earlier, they played in two World Series, winning one. They played their games. Their home field was League Park. Now, with that in mind, this team came to prominence during the war and just after. So for a snapshot in time, here's what America and Cleveland was going through in post-World War II. The country had emerged as a geopolitical superpower. There was economic prosperity. There were jobs. I mean, Cleveland was a bustling industrial town. We'd also discovered that women were a viable part of the employment platform. They were working outside the home. And in looking at some of the folks who logged in, many, me included, were a product of this generation of those soldiers and other military returning home. The baby boom started. But there was also disenfranchisement going on in the country. And those who may be unfamiliar with that term, you may recall after Reconstruction, there were a series of laws, new constitutions, put in place to deliberately prevent Black citizens from either registering to or to complete the voting process. Now, many of these laws were instituted mainly in the southern states, but they were practiced throughout the country. Now, 1947, the year we're going to talk about, may be viewed by many as a year of hope. For example, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the NAACP, appealed to the United Nations against racism in this country. The Congress of Racial Equality sponsored an interracial bus trip through the South to test compliance with the Barnes Act to make sure that there was equity in bus travel and integration. The President's Commission on Civil Rights attacked racial injustice in this country in a report titled To Secure These Rights. An outgrowth of that was the country saying that there would be no further discrimination or disparate treatment in any branch of the armed forces. And as we all know, Major League Baseball began the integration process. Now, while those are considered hopeful for signs, from a Negro League baseball standpoint, this sort of hit a death knell. And what we're going to talk about tonight in greater detail is the next to the last World Series play by Negro League teams. And leading us through that is Dominick Denaro. Those who don't know Dominick, just want you to know he's got an interest in Negro League baseball that goes several decades. Along with Dave Lawrence, he co-authored the book Eastern Colored League. Now, if you haven't read the book, let me just share with you a review that was done by Kevin Johnson, and this appeared on the Seamhead's website in 2008. An excerpt reads, "It is an undiscovered treasure of information about the Negro Leagues, about major league equivalents, about baseball simulation gaming, and most of all, about answering the question, how good were the Negro Leagues? And it's done in a rational and systematic fashion." And let me tell you, you heard what Michael Matthews said. Those of you who have not heard Dominick, sit back, relax, because you're going to do what Joe Shaw put in that email to you inviting you here. You're going to relive that World Series game. And on that note, I'm going to turn it over to my good friend, Dominick Denaro.
Thank you so much, Ike. Thank you, everyone. Now, if you can bear with me while I fumble through sharing the screen and resizing all of you so I can see the screen. We're getting somewhere.
Hey, getting somewhere.
All right. As Ike said, we're going to take a look tonight at the 1947 Negro League World Series, which took place 75 years ago last month between the Cleveland Buckeyes and the New York Cubans. Now, entering 1947, the Negro Leagues were enjoying unprecedented stability and prosperity. In the East, you had the Negro National League, founded in 1933, six teams in seven cities, mostly along the Eastern Seaboard, Homestead Grays splitting their time between Pittsburgh and Washington, D.C. And in the Midwest and South, there was the Negro American League, founded 10 years earlier, also a six-team circuit, also in seven cities, the Clowns splitting their time between Cincinnati and Indianapolis. 1947 was the fourth season in a row in which these 12 teams made up the two leagues, which was unheard of stability for Negro League baseball. But 1947, of course, would be a year of seismic change. Just before the end of spring training, the Brooklyn Dodgers made Jackie Robinson the first Black major leaguer since Moses Fleetwood Walker 63 years earlier. Jackie's success with the Dodgers changed baseball and changed America. And though it wasn't understood at the time, the integration of the major leagues sounded a death knell for the Negro Leagues. This here is the top of the sports section of the Pittsburgh Courier, June of 1945. Banner headline about the Homestead Grays and Birmingham Black Barons, Negro League statistics and standings, and stories of other black ball action. Now that same newspaper 2 years later, during Jackie Robinson's rookie year with Brooklyn. The headlines about Jackie and the Dodgers. The stats and standings have been replaced with the Robinson box score. There's even a ghostwritten article on the right, Jackie Robinson says. Further down the page, we can read about Jackie being named Negro Father of the Year. And down in the bottom corner, next to an advertisement for the Electric Light Jazz Bow Tie, you'll find two paragraphs about a series between the Newark Eagles and New York Cubans. In July, the Cleveland Indians purchased Larry Doby from the Newark Eagles, integrating the American League. A week later, the Black Cleveland Call and Post ran a front page photo spread documenting Doby's every move. coverage that earlier might have been spent on the city's first place Buckeyes. By the end of 1947, five Black players had reached the major leagues. There was no turning back for neither Major League Baseball nor the Negro Leagues, which swiftly declined in popularity and relevance. Which is a shame because a very entertaining season was playing out. At the time of Dobie's signing, the Cleveland Buckeyes were outpacing the defending champion Birmingham Black Barons and perennial contenders Kansas City Monarchs in the Negro American League, while in the Negro National League, the Newark Eagles, 1946 World Series winners, were neck and neck with a fine New York Cuban ball club. The Buckeyes, led by their star Sam Jethro, held off the challengers to claim their second NAL title in 3 years. While in the NNL, Newark faded after selling Dobie to the Indians, and the Cubans became New York City's first pennant winner of the Negro League era. The regular season ended at the start of September, followed by a couple of weeks of interleague exhibitions before the World Series. During this interlude, the two pennant winners faced each other in Buffalo and split a pair of games in a World Series preview. 2 weeks after that, on September 19th at the Polo Grounds in New York, the Buckeyes and Cubans met in the opening game of the 1947 Negro World Series. We're going to take a closer look now at the two ball clubs. The Cleveland Buckeyes were the 11th Negro League team to call the Lake Erie City home. Most of the previous 10 lasted just one season. None played more than two. But the Buckeyes succeeded where the others failed. Founded in 1942 as the Cincinnati Cleveland Buckeyes, they made Cleveland their permanent home 1 year later. They split their games between League Park and Cleveland Stadium, the two homes of the Major League Indians. The Buckeyes won their first NAL pennant in 1945, then upset the Homestead Grays in four straight to claim the Negro League championship. After a disappointing third place finish in 46, they reclaimed the pennant with many of the same players who won the crown in 1945. This is Cleveland's typical batting order during the 47 World Series. The team's star was center fielder and leadoff hitter Sam the Jet Jethro, 30-year-old switch hitter. And the statistics at seam heads for wins above replacement ranked Sam Jethro second during his career in the Negro American League behind Hall of Famer Willard Home Run Brown. He was a Buckeye since their first season in 42, starting center fielder for the West in four East-West games, joined Jackie Robinson and Marvin Williams in a sham tryout with the Boston Red Sox in April in 45, and later that year led the Buckeyes to their World Series sweep of Homestead. Batting second, Archie Ware, 29-year-old first baseman. Like Jethro, a Buckeye since 1942 and a regular on the 45 champions, a slick fielding contact hitter, starting all-star first baseman for the West, 44, 45, and 46. Batting third baseman Leon Kelman, a 28-year-old from Gatun, Panama. He was a superstar in the Panamanian Winter League, where he usually played catcher. Kelman joined the Buckeyes after the war in 46. He was a solid hitter with extra base power. In the cleanup spot, Joe Atkins, 25-year-old outfielder, third baseman, joined the Buckeyes from the Pittsburgh Crawfords of Branch Rickey's short-lived United States League. Atkins was the Buckeyes' one real home run threat in the batting order. Batting fifth, Willie Grace, 30-year-old switch hitter, a Buckeye since 43, another solid batter in the lineup. He took over for an AWOL Lloyd Davenport in the 45 World Series and wound up one of the hitting stars of the Buckeye sweep of the Mighty Grays. Grace was the starting right fielder for the 1946 East-West game. Batting sixth, Quincy Troop, 34-year-old catcher and team manager, born Christmas Day, 1912. Troop's vagabond career makes him one of the more difficult black ball stars to evaluate. He debuted with his hometown St. Louis Stars as a 17-year-old in 1930. And after that, played in the Negro National League, East-West League, Negro American League, Mexican League, barnstormed independently with the Kansas City Monarchs, spent 2 years as Satchel Paige's teammate on an integrated semi-pro team in Bismarck, North Dakota, joined Cleveland in 1945 as catcher and manager, and promptly led the team to a World Series championship. He was also a hell of a ball player, a hell of a hitter. You take the 10 years, 1938 to 1947, and he compiled a 926 on-base plus slugging over those 10 years, which ranks 13th amongst all Black hitters and second among catchers, behind Josh Gibson and ahead of Roy Campanella. Batting seventh, Al Fuzzy Smith, 19-year-old shortstop, signed by the Buckeyes a year earlier after graduating from high school in St. Louis. Number eight, Johnny Cowan, second baseman, 34-year-old from Alabama, who broke into black ball with the Birmingham Black Barons, joined the Buckeyes in their inaugural season in 1942, another mainstay of the 45 champions, a good field, no-hit second baseman. On the bench, there was at least one and possibly two Jesse Williamses. Pictured here is Jesse Sharon Williams from Meriden, Mississippi. Most sources identify him as a catcher, but on sceneheads.com, he's an outfielder, and there's a catcher named Jesse F. Williams, birthplace unknown, no photograph. The Baseball Heritage Museum has a team photo of the 47 Buckeyes that identifies Jesse Williams, Clyde Williams, and a third Williams without a first name. That might be this mysterious catcher, Jesse. In the event, this outfielder, Jesse Sharon Williams, was the only Jesse Williams to appear in the World Series. Clyde Nelson was a handy bench player who could play all the corner infield and corner outfield positions. A Chicago American Giant for 3 years, representing that team in the 1946 East-West game. 47 is Nelson's first year with the Buckeyes. On a pitching staff without a true ace starter, you had Eugene Smith, veteran fastball slider pitcher. He joined the Buckeyes late in the season from the Homestead Grays, and like so many others, missed three prime seasons of his career serving in the Army in World War II. Gene Bremmer was a New Orleans native, a four-time All-Star. Over the first 10 years of the Negro American League's existence, Bremmer ranks second in wins, behind Hilton Smith and ahead of Satchel Paige. In September of 42, Bremmer suffered a skull fracture and concussion in the car crash that killed Buckeyes Buster Brown and Smokey Owens, but he recovered to continue his fine career. He threw an overhand curve from a no-windup delivery and was a gold glove quality fielder on the mound. 40-year-old right-hander Chet Brewer was nearing the end of a long and successful career. He spent a dozen years as the ace of the Kansas City Monarchs and once lost a legendary pitcher's duel to Smokey Joe Williams, where the two pitchers combined for 46 strikeouts in 12 innings. He pitched to Quincy Troop for that integrated team in North Dakota, pitched for Trujillo's All-Stars in Santo Domingo in 1937, was the first Black American in the Mexican League, and pitched in two East-West games. Brewer was a finesse pitcher with a large repertoire of deliveries, joined the Buckeyes in 1946. Webbo Clark was a 19-year-old rookie southpaw from Panama. Herbert Doc Bracken went 13-1 for the Great Lakes Naval Station Black Blue Jackets during World War II, where he was a teammate of Larry Doby's. After the war, there was a bidding war for his services, which the Cleveland Buckeyes won. The fireballer struck out over six batters per nine innings, but unfortunately walked an equal amount. In 1947, Doc Bracken played under the name Alfredo Bregagna in an ill-fated attempt at passing as Puerto Rican to get into organized baseball. He appears as Bregana in box scores and newspaper articles during the World Series. Ross Satchel Davis was a 28-year-old right-hander whose budding career had been interrupted by World War II. And Toothpick Sam Jones was a 21-year-old rookie who threw hard but was very wild. Now we'll take a look at the New York Cubans. For over 30 years, Alejandro Alex Pompeys owned and operated an East Coast team of predominantly Latin players, known by several different names over the years. In the 1920s, they were the Cuban Stars and members of the Eastern Colored League and American Negro League. Since 1935, Pompeys rechristened New York Cubans were members of the Second Negro National League. Though the roster changed frequently, Pompeys' connections in his native Cuba and throughout Latin America ensured a solid lineup featuring some of the brightest stars in blackball. While they were regular contenders, 1947 marked the Cubans franchise's first Negro League pennant. And it's important to remember when talking about any of these Cuban ball clubs, that for Latin American players, the Negro Leagues were an off-season barnstorming tour. In their homelands, in the winter leagues, they were stars. They had their pictures on baseball cards. People knew them. Those were the teams that most of these players considered their real ball club. And the Cubans was something they did in the offseason. Managing that team, 51-year-old Jose Maria Fernandez, a mainstay of Pompeys' Cubans teams since their beginning in 1916, first as an excellent defensive catcher and later as manager. This vastly underrated figure also played 24 winters in his native Cuba, where he batted over 309 times. He was elected to the Cuban Baseball Hall of Fame in exile in 1965. Like the Buckeyes, the Cubans' biggest star was their leadoff hitter, a sensational 21-year-old named Saturnino Orestes Armas Viñoso Arrieta, better known as Mini Viñoso. He's in his second season in New York, starting third baseman for the East in the 1947 East-West game, and his 915 OPS, according to Scene Heads, ranked second in the Negro National League. 23-year-old Cuban Fernando Diaz Pedroso, who can be found in reference materials under either last name, was a very fast runner, but usually not much of a hitter. His nickname was El Bicho, which is literally the bug. But when I Googled it, I found there are several vulgar alternative meanings that I won't get into here. The number three hitter, 27-year-old Lorenzo Cabrera. His nickname was Chiquitine, which means tiny or little boy, and was probably ironic because he was a big, hard-hitting left-handed first baseman. His Cuban League career had been interrupted by World War II. 1947 was the 27-year-old's first season in the United States. Cleanup hitter Silvio Garcia was a big star in Latin America, usually on the hitting leaderboards in the Mexican League and Cuban League. The 33-year-old Cuban native broke in as a 17-year-old pitcher and moved to shortstop after an arm injury. He joined the New York Cubans in 1946 and played in the East-West game both of his seasons with the club. 6'2", 215-pound Claro Duane was nicknamed El Gigante, the giant. He was slow-footed and a defensive liability, but the man could hit. In the previous three seasons of the Cuban League, Duane won two batting titles and a home run crown. He led the 1945 Mexican League in batting average, hits, doubles, and runs batted in, and added the second batting championship in that league in 46. Duane played for the New York Cubans for one season in 1944 and returned in 47, where he made the East-West team. Batting sixth, 28-year-old Cuban catcher Rafael Rey Noble, a New York Cuban since 1945, strong-armed catcher, solid hitter with good power. 27-year-old Cleveland Clark, another Cuban native, was a speedy and graceful center fielder. His nickname was Chiflan, which means to be crazy about something, also to whistle or boo. Horacio Rabbit Martinez was probably the first great Dominican shortstop, a defensive wizard but weak at the plate. New York Cuban off and on since their founding in 1935, represented that team in four East-West games. He's 34 years old in 1947 and had moved to second base a year earlier when Silvio Garcia joined the Cubans. Years later, Rabid Martinez scouted for the New York and San Francisco Giants and was responsible for the first wave of Dominican major leaguers, including Juan Marichal, the Alou brothers, and Manny Mota. On the bench, 27-year-old Lou Loudon, catcher from Virginia, split the playing time behind the plate with Ray Noble. Loudon was a product of New York City playgrounds discovered by Alex Pompeys in 1942 and an East-West game selection in 46 and 47. Mario Arriosa was a promising 21-year-old rookie and part-timer who joined New York after hitting 296 in the Cuban League the previous winter. Ace of the pitching staff wearing uniform number one, Dave Barnhill, 33-year-old from North Carolina. Barnhill stood only 5'6", 168 pounds, but was a flamethrower who averaged over six strikeouts per nine innings. Led the Cuban League in strikeouts in 40-41 and joined the New York Cubans that spring. A gate attraction who engaged in some famous showdowns with Satchel Paige, including the 1943 East-West game, one of Barnhill's three East-West appearances. Barnhill got his start in black ball with gimmicky teams like the Ethiopian Clowns and Zulu Giants in the late 30s. His clown name was Impo, and that stuck with him as his nickname for the rest of his career. Luis Lefty Tiand was a 40-year-old from Havana. 5'10", 150 pounds, also nicknamed Sir Skinny. Tiant was a crafty junk baller with an excellent screwball and an even better pickoff move. According to James Riley, he once struck out a batter while throwing to first base. Tiant was a regular participant in the Cuban League and with Cuban Stars and New York Cubans teams in the U.S. His sterling record in 1947 earned him his second East-West game appearance and first since 1935. He's the father, of course, of Louis Tiant Jr., El Tiante, who starred on the mound for Cleveland and Boston in the 1960s and 70s. And I remember Lefty Tiant from NBC's coverage of the 1975 World Series. Fidel Castro gave the elder Tiant special dispensation to leave Cuba for the United States and see his son pitch for the Red Sox in the World Series. And NBC's cameras frequently captured the joyous old man celebrating in the stands. Back to the pitching staff, Barney Morris, 37-year-old from Shreveport, Louisiana, known as Big Ad. Another one of those Depression-era vagabonds. He was Quincy Troup's teammate in North Dakota with the Kansas City Monarchs and with Monterey in the Mexican League. Morris's bread and butter was a knuckleball he threw as hard as his fastball. New York Cuban since 1942, pitched in two East-West games, led the Cuban League in wins in 1939-40. Lino Galata Donoso. I love saying that name. He was a 25-year-old hurler from Havana, joined New York this year after a promising rookie season in the Cuban Winter League. Patricio Athelstan Scantleberry was a 29-year-old southpaw from Gatun, Panama, the same hometown as Buckeyes Leon Coleman. A Cuban since 1944, he also played in the Cuban and Puerto Rican winter leagues. Martin Crew was a 27-year-old left-hander from Mobile, Alabama, who featured on the back end of New York Cubans pitching staffs since 1942. Now, with all that context behind us, let's proceed with the games of the 1947 Negro World Series between the Cleveland Buckeyes and the New York Cubans. Game one on a Friday night at the Cubans' home park, the Polo Grounds in New York, a pair of veteran aces, Chet Brewer and Dave Barnhill. Cleveland took a 5-0 lead in the second on Johnny Cowan's 3-run homer off reliever Pat Scantlebury. Basilio Garcia helped New York tie the game, hitting a single, double, and homer in his first 3 trips to the plate. The game was called due to rain after 6 innings, a 5-5 tie. For Cleveland, 5 runs, 7 hits, 1 error. New York, 5 runs, 8 hits, 3 errors. 2 days later, on Sunday afternoon, the teams met at Yankee Stadium. Vibert Clark on the mound for Cleveland, Louis Tiant for New York. And Tiant faced just 4 batters before being knocked out of the box by a flurry of Buckeye hits. Leon Kelman's double and Joe Atkins' triple helped put Cleveland in front 3-0. The Cubans responded by driving Vibert Clark out of the game before he'd retired a batter. Doc Bracken came on in relief and skillfully pitched out of a no-out, bases-loaded jam to hold the New Yorkers to 2 runs. A single, 3 doubles, and triples by Al Smith and Bracken netted the Buckeyes 4 runs in the fourth. But Smith committed 2 errors, and Bracken balked in a run as New York tallied 4 in the bottom half to tie things at 7. In the sixth, Cubans shortstop Silvio Garcia singled, extending his home hitting streak to 22 straight games. Still tied at 7, Cleveland's Archie Ware leads off the top of the ninth with an infield single off New York reliever Lino Donoso. Leon Kelman singled, his 4th hit of the day, then Joe Atkins walked to load the bases with nobody out. Donoso then proceeded to retire Willie Grace and Quincy Troop. Bases still loaded, 2 outs. But Al Smith and Johnny Cowan connected for back-to-back singles to put Cleveland up by 3. Bracken retired the Cubans quietly in the bottom of the ninth to preserve the Buckeyes' win. For Cleveland, 10 runs, 17 hits, and 4 errors. For the Cubans, 7 runs, 10 hits, and 3 errors. The winning pitcher was Doc Bracken. Of course, the newspapers said it was Alfredo Bregana. The losing pitcher was Lino Donoso, and Cleveland takes a 1-0 lead in the series. The teams were scheduled to play in Shibe Park in Philadelphia Monday night, but rain postponed that contest until later in the week. Instead, the series resumed Tuesday night in cavernous and mostly empty Cleveland Stadium. Barney Morris on the mound against Eugene Smith. And through 7 innings, both starters were throwing shutouts. Sam Jones replaced Eugene Smith in the 8th, but the game remained scoreless. Minny Mignoso led off the Cubans' 9th by doubling the left field. Fernando Diaz fanned for the first out, then Lorenzo Cabrera walked. Silvio Garcia's base hit brought home Mignoso with the game's first run. Claro Duane followed with an RBI single to right. When Lou Loudon walked to load the bases, the Buckeyes brought Satchel Davis in from the pen to replace Sam Jones. Davis proceeded to walk Rabbit Martinez to force in the Cubans' 3rd run. Cleveland Clark reached on an error by shortstop Al Smith. Duane scored on the play, but Loudon was thrown out trying to score for the 2nd out of the inning. And the New York pitcher Barney Morris capped off the inning with a single to right, making it 6-0 Cubans. Morris went on to complete the shutout. His outstanding pitching line, 9 innings, 5 hits, no runs, no walks, 6 strikeouts. For the Cubans, 6 runs, 12 hits, no errors. The Buckeyes, no runs, 5 hits, 1 error. Winning pitcher Barney Morris. The loser, toothpick Sam Jones. The series returned to Philadelphia Wednesday night for game four, knotted at 1-1 plus the one tie. Gene Bremmer for Cleveland, Dave Barnhill making his second start of the series for New York. In a game that received minimal newspaper coverage, Ray Noble hit a grand slam onto Shibe Park's left field roof to lead New York to a 9-4 win. For the Cubans, 9 runs, 12 hits, no errors. The Buckeyes, 4 runs, 7 hits, 4 errors. Winning pitcher, Impo Barnhill. The loser was Gene Bremmer. We go to game 5, Friday night in Chicago. The Cubans have a 2-1 lead in the series. Chet Brewer opposing Lino Donoso. And Donoso scattered 7 hits in the Cubans' 9-2 victory. Rabbit Martinez starred defensively, twice robbing Johnny Cowan of line drive singles. For the Cubans, 9 runs, 14 hits, and 1 error. For Cleveland, 2 runs, 7 hits, and another 4 errors, giving them 14 through 5 games. Lino Donoso got the win, bringing his record to 1-1 in the series. Chet Brewer took the loss. And to give you a sense of how anonymous this World Series was, researchers are yet to find a box score of this contest. In fact, 1947 was the only one of the 11 editions of the Negro World Series for which we have no play-by-play accounts for any of the games. On Saturday, the series returned to Cleveland, League Park this time, with the Cubans up 3-1 and needing just one victory to claim the title. Louis Tiant opposing Eugene Smith. And Lefty Tiant was again knocked out early, making way for Pat Scandalberry after giving up 3 runs in the first 2 innings. Tiant's record for the series, 2 games started, 2 1/3 inning pitched, 6 runs scored. We don't know earned from unearned runs, but it becomes a run average of 23.14 for the series. Silvio Garcia was ejected in the 4th for loudly protesting an umpire's decision. And after 5, the Buckeyes led 5-0. Willie Grace drove in the first 4 runs with a single and a double. But the Cubans came back with 3 runs in the 6th. Cleveland second baseman Johnny Cowan committed errors on consecutive plays during the rally. In the 8th, Ray Noble put the Cubans on top with a 2-RBI double. And Pat Scantlebury shut out the Bucks over the last 4 frames to seal the win. For the Cubans, 6 runs, 8 hits, and 4 errors. For the Buckeyes, 5 runs, 9 hits, and 4 errors. Pat Scantlebury, the winning pitcher, Eugene Smith, the loser. And as the headline reads, the New York Cubans win the Negro World Series. It was New York City's first and only Negro League championship, and the only title won by any of the iterations of the Cuban Stars teams in the Negro Leagues. The Cubans averaged 7 runs per game, outscoring the Buckeyes 42-26, and profited from Cleveland's 18 errors over the 6 games. Statistics from the series are incomplete because of that missing game in Chicago, so we don't know exactly who the statistical leaders are. But for the games we do have, the leading regulars in the slash line stats are this pair of Buckeyes, Leon Kelman and Al Smith. The leading hitters for the Cubans were Lorenzo Cabrera, Claro Duani, and Silvio Garcia. No pitcher won multiple games in the series, but the best pitching performance was Barney Morris's Game 3 shutout. And my choice for World Series Most Valuable Player is Cubans catcher Ray Noble. Though he split playing time behind the plate with Lou Loudon, he had a huge impact on the series, hitting a grand slam in the Cubans' 9-4 winning in Game 4 and the series winning RBI double in Game 6, plus a gaudy slash line as a part-timer of 400, 500, 800, 1300. Now a different set of statistics, and these always depress me. This chart compares attendances for the Negro League and Major League World Series in 1947. And as you see, the average white World Series game drew 55,000 plus, which is more than double the number of people who attended all six games of the Black World Series combined. Because of the presence of Jackie Robinson in the previously all-white World Series, this disparity was even reflected in the coverage given by Black newspapers. This is the front page of the October 4th Cleveland Call and Post. Banner headline, Jackie Robinson stars in series games, photos of Jackie in action. On the front page of the sports section, the lead story is an editorial poem entitled Dreams Come True, Jackie in World Series. And down on the right, buried behind coverage of Black players in professional football, is the article detailing the Cubans' victory over the Buckeyes, which suggests that the real legacy of the 1947 Negro League World Series can be found in the stories of what its participants moved on to in baseball's newly integrated landscape. But first, let's acknowledge a trio of pitchers who were born too soon to take advantage of the new opportunities. Louis Tiant, Chet Brewer, and Barney Morris were certainly major league talents who could have starred in an integrated major leagues. But in 1947, they were all between the ages of 37 and 40, too old to be of any interest to white scouts. These seven players, Mario Ariosa, Lorenzo Cabrera, Claro Duani, Silvio Garcia, Leon Kelman, and Lou Loudon, chose to extend their careers in the racially friendlier Mexican League. Lorenzo Cabrera led the Mexican League in hitting in 1950, and Mario Ariosa, who was a 21-year-old part-timer with the 47 Cubans, would win two batting titles and a home run crown in the Mexican League in the 1950s. He's enshrined today in the Salón de la Fama, the Mexican Baseball Hall of Fame. These four Buckeyes, Joe Atkins, Gene Bremer, Willie Grace, and Archie Ware, played in the lower levels of minor league baseball. And Dave Imbo Barnhill made it as far as the New York Giants' top farm club, the Minneapolis Millers of the American Association, where he was a teammate of a young Willie Mays. Barnhill won 11 and lost 3 for the Millers in 1950, and probably only stayed in the minors because of the racial quotas employed by major league teams in the early days of integration. And that leaves these nine veterans of the 1947 Negro League World Series who reached the promised land of Major League Baseball. The first of them was also the best. Minnie Mignoso was the Cubans' 21-year-old third baseman and leadoff hitter in 1947. In 1949, he debuted with the Cleveland Indians. Little used in Cleveland, he was traded in 1951 to the Chicago White Sox, for whom he became a franchise legend and one of the best outfielders in the American League. With cameo appearances with the White Sox in 1976 and 1980, at the ages of 52 and 56, Mignoso became the major league's only five-decade player. And this past summer, at long last, Minnie Mignoso found his rightful place amongst the sports immortals with his enshrinement in the National Baseball Hall of Fame. The second 1947 vet to reach the major leagues was the Buckeyes' brightest star, leadoff hitter Sam the Jet Jethro. Jethro was 33 years old when he made his Boston Braves debut, which was ancient for a ballplayer whose primary weapon was speed. But Jethro was still good enough to be selected National League Rookie of the Year in 1950 and led the league in stolen bases each of his first two seasons. He would end his professional career in 1958 with Toronto in the International League, for whom he'd managed 24 stolen bases as a 40-year-old. Cuban catcher Ray Noble, my selection for series most valuable player, would spend parts of three seasons with the New York Giants in 1951. In October of that season, he came off the bench to catch the final inning of the famous Bobby Thompson home run game. Noble would continue playing at the AAA level until he was 42 years old. In 1947, Toothpick Sam Jones was a raw 21-year-old pitching hopeful. He would debut with Cleveland Indians in 1951, but spent most of his time in the high minors until a 1955 trade to the Cubs. That season, Jones became the first African-American to throw a no-hitter in the major leagues, pitched in the All-Star game, and true to form, led the National League in strikeouts, walks, and hit batsmen. The high point of Jones's 12-year major league career came in 1959, when he led the National League with 21 wins and a 2.83 ERA while pitching for the San Francisco Giants. He finished second to the White Sox early win in the Cy Young Award voting that year and would have won the National League Cy Young if they'd awarded one in each league as they do today. Excuse me. In January 1948, just 4 months after the World Series, the Cleveland Buckeyes inexplicably sold catcher and manager Quincy Troupe to the Chicago American Giants. After a season in Chicago, he would serve as player manager for an independent minor league team in Quebec and for Jalisco in the Mexican League. In 1952, at the age of 39, Troupe was finally given a crack at the major leagues. He played in 6 games over a 3-month span with the Cleveland Indians before being optioned to Indianapolis of the American Association. Troupe talks about his disappointment with these events in his excellent autobiography, 20 Years Too Soon. After a brilliant 22-year career, Troupe was told by Indians general manager Hank Greenberg he was being farmed out because, quote, one thing you don't have is a record that we can go on. In that autobiography, Troupe also spoke of his young teammate Al Smith and the promising future he had as a major leaguer. Smith debuted with the Indians in 1953, a year after Troupe, and enjoyed a 12-year major league career with Cleveland and the White Sox. A 2-time All-Star, Smith is best known for having a beer dumped on his head by an over-exuberant White Sox fan during Game 2 of the 1959 World Series. Lino Galata Donoso would pitch for the Cubans from 47-49, then spent 4 solid seasons in the Mexican League, winning the earned run average crown in 1951. He joined organized ball in 1954 with Hollywood in the Pacific Coast League. His 19-8 record and 2.37 earned run average with the Stars earned Donoso a major league call-up with the Pittsburgh Pirates in 1955, a rookie at the age of 32. He won 4 and lost 6 in 2 seasons with the cellar-dwelling Pirates, then returned to Mexico, where he would continue pitching until 1962. He was elected to the Mexican Baseball Hall of Fame in 1988. Panamanian Webo Clark, 19 years old with the 47 Buckeyes, would stay in the Negro Leagues until 1955, then joined Charlotte in organized baseball Sally League, where he went 16-12 and earned a September call-up with the Washington Senators. He pitched in 7 games for the Senators that month without neither a win nor a loss, then returned to the minor leagues for 2 more seasons before calling it a career. Our final major league debutant was Panamanian southpaw Pat Scantlebury, who shaved 8 years off his true age to get a chance at organized ball in 1953. In 1956, after several strong minor league seasons, the 38-year-old Scantlebury got called up by the Cincinnati Reds, for whom he pitched 6 games before returning to the International League for the rest of his career. By 1956, Scantlebury's rookie season, there were 33 veterans of Negro League baseball playing in the previously all-white major leagues, including, highlighted in yellow, 8 future Hall of Famers. More tellingly, there were 7 young African-Americans in the major leagues that season who had been signed directly into organized baseball and had never played in the major leagues. And that's the ultimate legacy of Negro League baseball. It succeeded so well in elevating Black baseball that it made itself obsolete. Among my sources for this presentation, Dick Clark and Larry Lester's Negro League book, Tom Dunkel's excellent colorblind about that independent team, integrated team in North Dakota. Highly recommend that. Who's Who in Cuban Baseball, Larry Lester's Black Baseball in New York City. The Negro League books too, James Riley's indispensable biographical encyclopedia, History of the Mexican League, and Quincy Troop's aforementioned autobiography. Websites referred to include retrosheet.org, the Sabre Biography Project and Games Project, and the Negro League's up close at homeplate.wordpress.com. The statistics all came from Scene Heads, and the newspaper clippings came from the resources at the Cleveland Public Library and my subscription to newspapers.com. And with that, I will stop sharing and turn the floor over to what we refer to as
Q&A.
Questions, comments, and angry outbursts.
Well, there is a question in the chat box for you, Dominick.
Okay, let me see that. A couple of comments about two of the MLB stories, Sam Jones and Quincy Troop.
It's actually not a comment, Tom. Yeah. I just wanted to mention that I was listening to the, I'm so old that I was listening to the radio in 1955 when Toothpick Sam pitched his no-hitter. And there was a lot of drama. His ninth inning consisted of three walks and three strikeouts. Unfortunately, the order was three walks and then three strikeouts. Now, the game was close, so there was a lot of grumbling about Stan Hack leaving him in the game when he walked the first three batters in the ninth inning. But then came the three strikeouts, you know, balancing out his walk and strikeout totals that spanned his entire career. And so a wonderful day for Chicago Cubs fans.
Thank you. And what was the, you had another story, I thought.
Yeah.
The story about Quincy Troop on the 1952 Cleveland Indians is really a nightmare. And in my opinion, the worst bad guy was not Hank Greenberg. It was a manager. Refresh my name, my memory. Who was the manager of Cleveland in 52? Sure. But in any case, the point of the story is that people, not just Quincy himself, but people asked, why aren't you playing Quincy Troop? And he just flat out said, I'm not going to do that. You know, he's a bullpen catcher. That's what he's here for. So he got 10 at-bats total in 3 months. Disgraceful.
Dominick, this is Joe. Could you share your thoughts on what kind of a manager Quincy Troop was, following up David's comment?
From what I can tell, he must have been very good. He managed the Cleveland Buckeyes for three seasons and won two pennants in that time. He never had a problem, it appears, getting managerial jobs, be it in Mexico. As I said, he managed a season with a team, I believe it was the Provincial League in Quebec, Canada. He was a very smart man. I mean, that comes through every page of his autobiography. This is a thoughtful man. Somehow reading between the lines, I feel like he was probably an excellent people manager. That, you know, he could rally a group together behind him and pull toward a common cause.
You spoke highly of his book. What was it, 20 Years Too Soon?
If 20 I got Years Too Soon, yes.
Does the book delve into any of his managerial characteristics at all?
If it does, I'm not recalling off the top of my head.
Okay. Other questions for Dominick and or Ike
Well, let me toss in, Dave Scott helped us out. Al Lopez was the manager of the team in 52.
Okay.
Thank you, Dave.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, and Dave Lawrence. Got over that senior moment, did you?
Anyone have comments or questions?
Minnie Minoso, help me. I should know more than I do, but if I recall, I read somewhere that he was valued by the Indians as far as his talent, but they couldn't fit him in with, as you used the phrase, the quota system, so they shipped him out. Is that accurate at all, or am I missing some important features there?
That seems very accurate to me. Ms. Professor Lawrence, you were on the scene at the time.
Yeah, Bill Beck had some not so nice comments to make about Minnie's fielding at third base. And I think that was his reputation when he came up to the bigs in 49, was that, yeah, he was a comet on the bases, but where do you put him? And the answer eventually became in the outfield.
Dominick, there's a question about simulation in the chat box. Someone likes to pull on that thread, which I think would be real interesting.
Simulations were mentioned. Yes, it is not Stratomatic. It's APBA or APBA. David Lawrence and myself, a number of years back, crafted an APBA card set based on the Eastern Colored League of the 1920s.
Is that card set still available, or do you need to go to the aftermarket for it?
Or eBay.
Well, we wish many, many, many more copies of it had been printed. Unfortunately, you may have to go to the dark web or something.
Oh, my gosh.
These days.
Ooh, well, that may change that thought.
No, there are copies floating around, but there were only 200 total copies printed. So
okay,
that's too bad.
Again, you were ahead of your time, right?
Well, yeah, I found a wonderful partner in Dom. I was the APBA expert. He was the stats expert. And so, you know, we joined forces in a very nice way. He filled in the gaps that I had as a statistician.
And does have many, many Negro League seasons. I have a bunch of them. A lot of them are digital only, but there are some cards for many of the leagues too.
There is a fellow named Scott Simkus who's made Stratomatic sets, and he's very good. He's also contributed a lot to Seamheads. To throw a dark cloud over this meeting, I'm assuming you all know, but you may not, that Gary Ashwell suffered a serious heart attack 4 days ago. He's in the ICU in the hospital. And, you know, if you pray to anybody, please send your prayers for Gary, because we wouldn't be where we are without Seamheads. And it's just tragic. He's 54 years old. So it's too young to have a life-threatening heart attack.
Yeah, for sure. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that dark cloud news. Yeah.
Here's one other comment in the chat from Dave Bodimer. And this is directed to you, Dominick. As always, great presentation. It's like listening to Vin Scully.
Ooh, thank you so much for the high praise, Dave.
So one more opportunity for questions, comments, angry outbursts.
Yeah, Dominick, let me ask a question. If I, in looking at your charts and where you drew your, I'll call it newspapers.com information from, you seem to find a lot of it from more southern newspapers as opposed to more local, closer to the action, the two teams newspapers. Did I get that right, or did I totally misunderstand that?
No, there's multiple things going on here. The Cleveland Call and Post and Cleveland Plain Dealer were very critical to putting this together. The New York Black newspapers were not quite as helpful, but the New York Daily News, believe it or not, gave this World Series a little bit of coverage. In illustrating my presentation, I'm looking for a good-looking headline. And what you wind up finding on newspapers.com is somebody, the UPI or Associated Press or somebody, will run a two-paragraph story about the game that get picked up by 30 newspapers nationwide. Most of those are in the South, which is still where the majority of Blacks were living. And I was cherry picking what would look nicest visually in the presentation rather than concerning myself with what
newspapers. That's very good.
Because again, it was the same article in a dozen or two dozen newspapers.
Okay. You did touch a little bit on the lack of information, lack of data, that, and it seems like somewhat that's getting better, correct, through research by a variety of people, one of whom is on tonight, Ray Danner from our group, who is, it at least was, and Ray, if you come back on, at least for a moment, could you share with us if you're still doing that Negro League research?
Yeah, sure. I am. I have plans to get back out to Erie, Pennsylvania one more time, and then Meadville and maybe some other smaller towns along the routes that the ball clubs would have gone to. Just got to find the time to get in my car and drive out there because, you know, we're trying to find the ones that haven't been digitized. You've got to go to the source. You got to dig through the archives. It's a slow and painful process the way that it used to be done everywhere. But there's stuff out there and we're going to keep trying to find it. Somebody mentioned Scott Simkus. He's been a great resource. I've worked with him to find these box scores, and we found a couple dozen already.
Are you sensing more people are taking the challenge and doing what you're doing, or do you have any feel there?
No, not that I know of. I know, you know, Scott has spread the word. My buddy Travis Sawchick is a sports writer. He accompanied me and wrote a great article about it and said that there's more people needed, but not that I'm aware of. It'd be great if we did have some more people, though.
Okay.
But Ray, we should give a shout out to people who have really devoted decades of their lives to collecting box scores, guys like Wayne Stivers and others. You know, it's just that it isn't as if there's money in it, and so it just is good works, the things that some of these guys have done.
Absolutely.
Well, thanks for sharing, Ray.
Mm-hmm. And thank you.
If I got a chance for one more question or not, this is Mike Tedrick down in Greenville, South Carolina.
Oh, wow.
Question about you mentioned the guy who struck out a batter when he was on his pickoff move to first. Can you elaborate on that a little bit?
I know no elaboration. The player in question was Louis Tiant Sr. And in James Riley's biographical encyclopedia of the Negro Leagues, there is a sentence in his piece on Louis Tiant that mentions he had an amazing pickoff move and supposedly once struck out a batter while throwing to first base. You know, James Riley was one of the pioneers who was collecting every piece of information he could get from every source possible. So, you know, my money would be on the story being apocryphal, but nonetheless, an informative image for what Tiant, and, you know, having grown up, watched his son's gyrations on the mound, it's not difficult to imagine a left-handed Tiant being that tantalizing with his pickoff move.
Thanks. That's great.
Well, Dominick, you and Ike have gotten another terrific presentation comment in the chat box, and very well deserved.
Thank you, Blake.
So, last call for tonight's questions. I think Herb is trying to ask a question, but Herb, you're on mute.
Can you unmute him,
Joe? I cannot unmute him.
Oh.
As much as I would like to, I can't. I can go the other way. Don't go there, but I can go the other way, but not.
Hey, Herb, you're going to have to get a 12-year-old to help you unmute.
Herb, we can't hear you, Herb.
Or either he's on the phone.
No, I sent him a note.
Oh, there he goes.
There you go, Herb. There is a Herb.
Yay. Right. I never knew there was a biographical encyclopedia of the Negro League. And I suspect any records from Mr. Easter would be in that document. Or is there another way?
He certainly has an entry in there.
Yeah, he's there.
Barely sizable. Yeah,
I just never heard of the book. That's why I was.
It's the Bible. It's the Bible for me, yeah. These researchers. It's your starting off point for anything, any move you make in this field.
Yeah. I'm going to see if I can scrounge one up somewhere.
It's going to be tough to find. They're out of circulation, but
there's used copies available online. You might have to pay a bit for them, but they're out there. James Riley is the author. R-I-L-E-Y.
What is the exact title, Dominick?
Hold on.
Oh, I hold on. I should. Oh my! Everybody's leaving. Who's going to come back first? Dominick went to the New York Met City Field to get his copy.
We've got two different editions. Look at there. Yeah, you've got the hardcover with your slip jacket. And my weird thing, my background keeps getting rid of it. I disappear. Biographical Encyclopedia of the Negro Baseball
League.
By James A. Riley.
And the foreword is Monty Irvin. Thanks, Ray.
And my copy is 952 pages.
I think
we're looking at a truly encyclopedic work here.
Yeah, the incredible thing about Jim Riley's book is the number of players he talks about. I mean, some of us may know 200 or 300 Negro League players, and you know he knows 10,000. And so it really is a work of a lifetime to collect all of that information.
And Luke Easter is on page 261.
You beat me to it. I was doing the same thing you did.
Maybe we'll get some proceeds from the Amazon sales tonight.
Yeah, and if you study Negro League baseball, you need this book.
Yeah,
and
my hard
Block and Lester come next.
Ike, my hardcover copy, the binding ripped, and it is multiple pieces, but I still hold on to it because of the notes I've scribbled in it. But I bought a used copy on Amazon just to have one that I could turn pages of.
Yeah.
It's invaluable.
And if you haven't seen it, Ray Danner put the Amazon.com lead in the chat box. Thank you, Ray.
Perfect.
All right. One more time. Last call. Any questions for
Thank you.
Well, can I try something that borders on shameless self-promotion?
You may shamelessly self-promote whoever you would like.
Well, it's the Community Cup Classic Foundation. And as Michael Matthews mentioned at the beginning, monthly, we've been putting on presentations. And on November 14th or 15th, Dominick will be sharing about those players already, some players already in the Hall of Fame. And in December, I'll be doing one, which Michael alluded to, that's a virtual tour of the ballparks that Negro League teams in Cleveland played in. And this is a byproduct of the project with the Jack Graney chapter to chronicle all baseball parks in the greater Cleveland area. So if any of you are so inclined, you can get to the Community Cup Classic Foundation through their website, communitycupclassicfoundation.com, and you need to register for each of the programs that you plan to attend. And we also found out a little earlier that we will continue these during 2023. So some highlight events that we will talk to and through would be the 90th anniversary of the Major League Baseball All-Star Games, as well as it being the 90th anniversary of the East-West All-Star Games. We'll also have the 75th anniversary of the Cleveland baseball franchise's last World Series championship, which gives an opportunity to talk to and talk about Satchel Paige and Larry Doby. And we should also speak to the very last Negro League World Series that was played, the Homestead Grays and Luke Easter against the Birmingham Black Barons and some kid named Mays. So hopefully you'll be able to join us for some or all of those programs.
They are excellent programs. Ike, that was some of the most fantastic shameless self-promotion I've heard in a long time. So a gold star for you.
And you were promoting me too, which is...
Yeah, that's right. That's who I was promoting.
Ah, I see.
Old What's-His-Name.
Old What's-His-Name, if only we knew old What's. Well, let us bring a close to what I hope you all felt was a very successful, productive, enjoyable evening. And again, I want to thank very, very much Ike and Dominick for putting this together and sharing it with us and talking with us and making us all a tad bit smarter about Negro League baseball and some of the players. So thank you very much. And with that, we're going to call it an evening.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure, good. Everyone.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Thanks again, everyone. See you the next time. Night.
Thank you all.
Okay.
Thank you.
The Yankees are losing, Joe.
3-2. 3-2.
not that Joe's been paid.